Good evening and welcome again to this service of worship to the risen and ascended Lord Jesus Christ. I'd just like to read some of these wonderful words from the prophet Isaiah. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense is before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. And it's a remarkable contrast we get in that passage, isn't it? That on the one hand, you've got the Lord who comes with might and rules. He is the one who, above all of the nations, has all power and authority in his hands. And yet at the same time, he's a tender God who cares for the weak, he cares for his people, he leads them gently, and he carries them in his own bosom. Our God is unlike any other. And so it's our privilege to come and to worship him. So I'd like to just offer a warm invitation to whoever's perhaps picking this up online. Perhaps you stumbled across it on your feed. Perhaps you've decided to check out this service and you don't normally come to church. You don't normally do this kind of thing. You're very welcome to continue watching this, to engage with this, and we hope that you are greatly blessed by it. I'm going to pray now, and the reason I'm going to pray, so I'm going to ask God that he would continue to bless us in this time together. Lord, there is no one like you. You are indeed unlike any other God. Lord, both mighty and tender towards your people. Lord, a just God and a saviour. A righteous God and yet full of mercy. A God of justice and the God of our salvation. Lord, there is no one like you in all of the earth. Lord, you are good, you are just. And Lord, we pray that this evening, that indeed, that your justice would be clearly displayed to us. And Lord, that we would see your mercy, especially as we consider your Son, Jesus Christ, the one who came into this world to rescue us, to redeem us, and to make us fit that we would be able to dwell with you. We pray this in his name. Amen. And we're going to sing our first hymn now. It's number 894 in the Blue Hymn Books. 894. Come, O Fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing your grace. And that's our prayer, that indeed God would tune our very hearts to sing of his praises and tune our hearts to hear from him this evening.
Streams of mercy never ceasing, God. wandering far away from God, and to rescue me from danger, shed for me his precious blood. Through God's grace I am his debtor, daily I this thought renew.
Just a few short notices again this evening. The first one is community groups. They're the kind of smaller groups that meet up on Skype or Zoom for the various areas of the town. They're going to be on as usual this week. If you are not in a community group but you'd like to find out more, then please do get in contact with us. The details of how to do that will be on a slide at the end of this service. And we'd be able to point you in the direction and the details to link in with your local community group. We just study the Bible together, normally on the basis of what was looked at in the morning service, and then we discuss that together and pray together. So you're very welcome to ask for details of that as well. There is on Tuesday an elders meeting, so please do pray for the elders. That the Lord would be guiding them in all of their discussions and thoughts. We really are dependent entirely on the prayers of the entire body here at Reynard Way. So please do pray for us. Pray that the Lord would give us wisdom and help us in every part of those discussions. And also the elders would like to just give thanks to you guys. They're very encouraged by the care and commitment that people are showing to each other, the number of ways which people are serving each other, so please do keep that up. And we give thanks to God for the various ways in which people are caring for one another and ministering to one another and making sure each other's needs are met. If you do have needs which aren't being met, if you have concerns or worries about people, then please do contact one of the elders and they'll see how they can help. Let's come and let's pray now to our Heavenly Father. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you that you are indeed a God of peace and a God of harmony. Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, we thank you that for all eternity you have dwelt in peace and harmony. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bound together in love. Lord, we thank you for that. And Lord, we thank you for the perfect unity which is shown between the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit and their eternal love for one another. And Lord, how that pictures in such a powerful way the love that we should show for one another. Lord, we confess that so often when we look at our own lives and we look at the world around us and Lord, even within our own fellowship as a church, we often don't see the perfect harmony that there should be. Lord, we often seek to have our own voices heard above others. Lord, we often seek to impose our will on other people. Lord, we have more of a concern for our own interests than we have concern for the interests of brothers and sisters. Lord, we pray that you would deal gently with our hearts. Lord, that you would deal with us nonetheless to bring us to a place of humility, that we would not think more of ourselves than we should. Lord, that we would that we would care more for one another's needs than our own. Lord, we pray for all of the relationships which make up our church. Lord, we thank you for each and every one of those. Lord, we pray for those relationships that perhaps within families or households are particularly under strain at the moment. Lord, we think of households where people are living together in much more confined circumstances than they would usually be. Lord, we find relationships that will be under strain because of the distance that is having to be set between them as well. Lord, we find the difficulty that internet communication can have upon us and the misinterpretation of things that people say. Lord, we pray for all of these situations and all of these pressures. Lord, we pray that you give us grace to deal with one another, that you give us forgiving hearts, and Lord, that we would be constantly praying for one another. Lord, when we come to one another in prayer, Lord, it softens our hearts towards one another. Lord, as you know, when we bear each other up before you, Lord, if that is part of the means which you use to bind us together in love for one another. And so, Lord, we pray, if there's anyone this evening who's listening to this, who perhaps has a difficulty with a brother or sister, perhaps unresolved things which, because of this lockdown, haven't been resolved, Lord, we pray that you would give them grace, you would give them mercy to seek reconciliation with their brother or sister. Father God, we pray that you would deal with us gently and tenderly. Lord, we would also pray for all of the brothers and sisters which find themselves on their own at this time. Lord, people who live alone and single folk, Lord, we thank you for them and the faithful ministry that so many of these people do in the church. Lord, we pray that they would know that they are not alone at this time, that they would know your care and your love for them, and Lord, that you would particularly uphold them at this particular time. Lord, we know of various situations where people can't be with loved ones that they care about. Lord, they're separated, perhaps from parents or children. Lord, we pray for those situations. And Lord, we pray that you would bless those particular people. May they know your peace and your comfort at this time. Lord, may you drive them to pray for one another. Lord, we also pray for a particular sister of ours, a dearly beloved sister who's had particular bad news about the health of her father this week, and Lord, we pray for her at this particular time. Lord, she has served so well in this church, and Lord, we do care for her, and Lord, we pray that she would know your comfort at this particular time. And Lord, we understand that it's an unbelieving parent, and Lord, we pray for her and her witness to that unbelieving parent as well. And Lord, we pray that she would be able to be a powerful witness of the love of Jesus Christ, that she would be able to shine your light into that particular relationship at this time, and that she would be a comfort and a support to them, just as you uphold her and help her. Lord, we pray that we as a body of believers would also be a support to her at this time. We pray for your blessing. And Lord, we pray for all of us now as we come to open up your word together, to read it together. Lord, open our hearts, open our minds, soften us and prepare us for this, Lord. There will be perhaps difficult things that we don't want to let go of as we open up this word. Lord, we pray that you would pry our clutch away from our own pride. Lord, that you would humble us. And Lord, that you would draw us together in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to sing another lovely Christian hymn from Christian Hymns, the Maroon Hymn Books, number 670. I will sing the wondrous story. And now Peter Sharp is going to be reading our Bible passage for us this evening, and he's going to be reading from the book of Philemon in the New Testament. You'll find that just before you get to Hebrews, and that's the book of Philemon, the whole thing.
Good evening, everybody. I trust that you're all safe and well. Tonight's reading is from the book of Philemon, the epistle of Paul to Philemon, verses 1 to 25. Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of your faith that you have towards the Lord Jesus Christ and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he indeed is useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf in my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own accord. For this perhaps is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might receive him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of you owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. At the same time, prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that through your prayers I will be graciously given to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you. So do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Let's read the word of God.
Thank you very much, Peter. And we're now going to be singing together number 772. That is the classic hymn, Amazing Grace.
Through many
be forever mine.
Well, this evening, again, it's my wonderful privilege to continue in our series Letters from Lockdown, as we consider those amazing letters that the Apostle Paul wrote to the churches whilst he himself was under house arrest, on lockdown, so to speak. He was kept within his home, he wasn't allowed to leave, but during that time he was able to send out all sorts of letters to churches, and particularly this evening we're going to be thinking about messages to individuals as well. And the particular theme that we're thinking about this evening is Paul's ministry of reconciliation during his house arrest. That is, he seems to take particular attention to the individual relationships and the corporate relationships within churches as he seeks to undergo a ministry of reconciling brothers and sisters who have fallen out for various reasons. And what we find from church history is that persecution and the opposition which early Christians experienced in the early church put a lot of pressures upon early Christians. Far from being a kind of a perfect and harmonious early church, a kind of golden era, there were all sorts of difficulties that were experienced by the earliest Christians. And some of those difficulties involved, what do we do with brothers and sisters who have buckled under the strain of persecution or held back? Do we allow them back into the fold? How do we do that when we do? And those sort of pressures and strains caused some of the earliest splinters and divisions of the early church. And today we find ourselves under lockdown, facing our own pressures and strains ourselves. And so what might it be today? Well, it might be that people find themselves stuck inside in much closer quarters with their own families or people they're living with than they were ever before. And so often it's easy to get along with people when you have your own space, when you're not crammed in together. But the closer you get to other people, and the closer you live with other people, those strains can start to bear their way out through those relationships and start to cause real difficulties. The distance itself can actually be a problem. Those people that we're not seeing on a regular basis means that perhaps things have been allowed to fester. Broken relationships which should have been repaired, issues which should have been sorted out, haven't been sorted out because we haven't been able to see people face to face. We've not had that same necessity and impetus to sort things out because we've got to get on with them, because we haven't seen those people. Perhaps even as I'm saying this, you're aware of situations in your own life, people who perhaps the last time you saw them, it wasn't the best of partings that you had with those people. On top of that, there's the well-documented difficulties which can so often come about because of internet communication. And so often over email or text messages, people can misunderstand the tone of a communication and get the wrong end of the stick and take things in a more negative way than they were intended. And people can get frustrated or angry with these communications and these misunderstandings which can happen. Or people can be perhaps more aggressive or unfair over text message communications in a way that they wouldn't if they were sat looking into the eyes and the face of the brother or sister. And also in the internet age, things are easy to share. Perhaps things which should have been just quietly said in private are easy to share with other people, which perhaps shouldn't be shared as well. And gossip and issues like that can very quickly get out of hand. And so the Paul's ministry of reconciliation, I hope that you're going to see this evening, has just as much relevance to us today in our situation as it's ever done. because the human heart still has the same fundamental problems with it that we have seen throughout human history. And so we're going to look at two specific examples. There's more than that in Paul's lockdown letters, but we're going to look at the two main specific examples that we get in his letters, and then we're going to think about some more foundational principles as we finish. But the first example that we're going to look at, our first point, is the relationship breakdown that's mentioned in Philippians between two ladies called Euodia and Syntyche. And it's a very brief mention. We get it in Philippians chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. And the background here is actually we don't really know a lot about these two ladies. We don't really know, apart from this passage, anything really about what's going on. And the passage doesn't really even contain what they had fallen out about anyway. They may well have been original converts. They obviously are important enough and a key part of the church there in Philippi that Paul is going to address them by name and urge them to agree in the Lord. And we know that they worked with Paul from this passage. They labored side by side with him in the gospel. They were gospel workers. And perhaps they would have been part of the original converts which Paul first made contact with down by the river in Philippi when Lydia was converted as well. There was a group of women that would meet down there to pray, and Paul went and preached and taught to them. But we don't know what the quarrel was about. We don't know what the details were about. They could have been practical issues about the church. They could have been kind of strategic ministry decisions. They could have been theological issues. They could have been questions about other people and their suitability for ministry. We really don't know the details. But actually, in some ways, that's really helpful to us, isn't it? Because the first thing that tells us is here, Paul doesn't want to be prescriptive. He doesn't want to just solve the issue for them. Right, Euodia's right, Syntyche, you've got to get your head around that. Or Syntyche's right, or it's part of one and part of the other, or you're both wrong, this is the solution. Paul is not at all prescriptive about this issue. He wants them to practice the godly habits that Christians should be learning to reconcile with each other. But at the same time, he does expect others in the church. He talks to a fellow companion. He does expect other people in the church to help these women to agree in the Lord. And that's actually really important, isn't it? That he's asking people to help in this situation. Now, as British people, we often kind of have this idea, well, we don't want to get involved in other people's business. We'll just kind of stick to the sidelines and maybe quietly gossip in the background about their disagreement and whose side we're on. But we don't want to get involved. We see that as meddling. But actually, we see here that this is a church issue. It's come to the fore, and it's important that other people help them to resolve whatever this issue is. And so they need to humbly point both Euodia and Syntyche to Christ. They need to remind them that they are sisters in the Lord, that Jesus Christ died for that sister as well to redeem them. Perhaps it might involve gentle and careful rebuking about perhaps things they've said. Perhaps it might involve restoring them gently where they've made a mistake, or showing love to them. But also, we've got to be very careful as well that we don't get involved in a bad way, and there's so many bad ways to get involved. Taking sides, starting to build up kind of allegiances with one person or another, gossip, or that thing just where when you're with Syntyche, you really do agree with her about how appalling Euodia was, but when you're with Euodia, it's kind of a bit awkward to say that to Euodia, so you just kind of nod your head and sound like you agree. But actually being willing to get involved, maybe get your hands dirty, maybe be involved maybe be willing to get involved in such a way that you might even be putting yourself in the firing line at time to time to try and resolve this dispute. But notice also, they are urged to agree. That Paul doesn't just say, well, you've got to agree to disagree. Or isn't it wonderful that these two women have these very diverse views? Actually, he's asking these two women to agree in the Lord. And that's a crucial thing, because what we'll come in onto just now, actually, is that there is such a thing as false unity. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 3, we're told that we should, yes, be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. But often in the world, and tragically even in churches, there's a couple of forms of false unity which kind of pass themselves off as counterfeits of true unity in the Spirit. And I'm going to go through those two just now. The first one is authoritarian unity. This is the kind of North Korean style of unity. That is that anyone that differs from the official line will simply be purged, just put out. It's often, and the characteristic part of it, is that that authority is particularly focused on a person or an organization. Dissent is punished. Anyone that disagrees will quickly be punished or booted out of the fellowship. Reconciliation isn't seen as important. Patience and long-suffering with other people isn't seen as important. Forgiveness isn't necessarily a given in these situations. It's a very top-down solution to any problems that may occur. Everyone needs to be in lockstep together. And we may have seen this throughout church history, especially in the Roman Catholic Church, where you could be anathematized if you disagreed with Roman Catholic doctrine. Or even today, you would see it in the Jehovah's Witnesses, for example, where you can be shunned if you disagree with core teachings of the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. And this isn't the model that the New Testament has. Yes, the New Testament does teach us that there is a place for Bible-led church discipline. And there is a time when those who are causing real damage to the flock need to be put outside the flock. But all of the time, that authority is not vested in individuals or institutions. That authority primarily is invested in Scripture. And that the New Testament church is to be a Scripture-led church. But that's one form of kind of false authoritarian leadership, which can sometimes find themselves even within evangelical churches, controlling pastors or people within particular ministries that want to control their particular ministry, or even just in personal relationships, as other people want to kind of dominate or control other people within the church. But the other type is also just as damaging at times as well, and that is truthless unity. This is where we celebrate that we're such a broad church and we're so inclusive that we actually have no bounds which will in any way really define who we are as a body of believers anymore. It's unity really in name only, that we can kind of sit in the same room and maybe call ourselves by the same collective title or denomination, but actually there's deep and profound differences in the very core doctrines that we hold about who God is, about how we're saved, about how we're supposed to live the Christian life or do ministry. And that's tragic as well. And often in these situations, there will be some sort of vague consensus that we're all for the kind of what we sometimes call motherhood and apple pie statements. You know, they're things you can't very easily disagree with. And so people say that, you know, we're for believing that God is a God of love, or we're all for generosity and goodness, because no one can really disagree with those things. But the second you go one inch beyond these sort of things, just celebrating our shared humanity, you can see that actually there's very deeply ingrained divisions that are just being veneered over by what we call truthless unity, which is no unity at all. Now, the problem with both authoritarian unity and truthless unity is they give refuge to that real problem at the heart of divisions within churches. They still allow the core of the problem to fester and to continue to spread, and that is human pride and arrogance. You see, in authoritarian unity, the authority can be as arrogant and proud as they want. They can impose their views on other people and have no interest in what those people that they're pushing out of the fellowship believe. They don't need to take any time to consider, actually, have I sought through the scriptures? Have I prayed about this? Am I really right about this? But also the same in truthless unity as well. You can be proud about the views that you can hold. You can be proud about what a wonderfully broad church you have. You can believe that you're right and the person you're sat next to is horrendously wrong. You just don't tell them that. And that's just as bad, isn't it? It gives refuge to pride, that most pernicious of sins in the human heart that actually is still able to work. But true unity can give no refuge at all, no hiding place for human pride and human arrogance. And that, I think, is the real reason why so many of us would actually want to avoid that. Because we love our pride. Our hearts are very proudly enthroned in their current situation, that we rule our own lives and we're right about all the things we think we're right about. And we don't take any time to prayerfully consider, to come before Scripture and allow it to have its influence over us. And so we have this amazing encouragement of Paul for Euodia and Syntyche, not just to agree to disagree, not for one of them to impose their will upon the other, or Paul to say lay down the law on what's right and what's wrong, but to themselves, with the help of their brothers and sisters there, to reconcile with one another, to agree in the Lord, to come to a conclusion about whatever it was. But another, perhaps an even more remarkable example we get from Paul's letters is to the letter Philemon, which Peter very helpfully read for us. And this actually went along with the letter to the Colossians. So the letter to the Colossians was for the whole church, but this personal letter was sent to Philemon at that same time. And that's helpful because we've just been going through the book of Colossians, and so we're aware of some of the background. But more of the specific background might well be helpful. We get this from the very letter itself, but I'll just summarize it quickly. Philemon had a slave, as was often the practice in those days, whose name was Onesimus. And it seems from what's written in the letter that at some point Onesimus seems to have stolen from his master Philemon and gone on the run, and left that place of Colossae and found himself in the kind of centre of the world at that time, Rome. And whilst he was in Rome, he came somehow into contact with Paul. We don't know if he sought out Paul or if he happened by the grace of God to come into contact with Paul. But in the course of his relating to Paul, he became a believer. As Paul put it, he became a father to Onesimus. And because of his conversion, his wonderful conversion, he became very useful in his ministry and service of Paul. But with that all as our context, what can we learn about this? Well, I just really want to go through two main things in this second point that we learn from our second example, Philemon and Onesimus. The first thing we learn is we see a beautiful model of reconciliation between these two. But we also see a wonderful model that Paul puts of his persuasion of Philemon in this particular incident as well. So if you're wondering, you know, how do I help out other people to agree in the Lord? Yoda and Syntyche, those sort of situations, how do I be that fellow companion that can help them? Well, Paul puts a fantastic way here of how we can be really persuasive in trying to convince people to show love and acceptance and forgiveness to those who have previously wronged them. So what do we learn about the model of reconciliation first? That was our first sub-point for this one. The first thing that we learn is that he sends Onesimus back, that he doesn't allow it to just continue in the current situation. He sees that Onesimus actually has wronged Philemon, just disappearing off whenever it was in the middle of the night, taking things that were his. He sends him back. The relationship shouldn't just be left having been broken and just left like that. It's too tricky, it's too messy to go back there. That he wants that relationship to be restored. Now, I don't know where you are. Perhaps there are things, maybe deep in your past, things which have happened in the past between you and someone else. And maybe even during this lockdown, you've had time to think about these things. Maybe it was years or decades ago. Remember that it is always a good thing to try and heal old wounds. And it can be a very helpful thing in this case. And so he sends back Onesimus to Philemon. But he doesn't just send him back. He shows the importance of it being resolved. Because, first of all, he informs Philemon that Onesimus is now a fellow believer, that he's changed, that he was once useless, but now he's become useful. It's a kind of pun, apparently, on the name Onesimus, which means useful. He actually is Onesimus now. He really is useful. He's been very useful to Paul. And so you're gaining back someone who is going to be a great help to you and your household. But he also points in verse 15 to the providences of God. Perhaps this is why he left. That yes, maybe it was sinful for what he did to just flee at that time, to steal from his master. But perhaps this is the very reason he went. In the same way, we get this wonderful picture of understanding of God's grace from the story of Joseph back in Genesis. Joseph, who was sold into slavery by his own brothers, just like Onesimus was a slave. And at the end of all that, when he has the upper hand and his brothers are relying on him, and his brothers are fearful that he might take revenge on them, he said, "You meant this for bad, but God meant it for good." That Joseph was able to see God's hand at work, even in these situations, even in the horrible murderous intent and then the selling him into slavery by his own brothers, that he was able to see God's merciful hand at work. And that's what Paul is pointing Philemon towards. See the hand of God. You lost a useless slave, but now you're regaining not a useful slave, but a brother. Because that's what he does next. He raises his status to brother, verse 16. You're not getting a slave back. You're getting a brother back. And I want you to treat him as you would a very brother, because that's who he is in Jesus Christ. And that's why this letter of Philemon was one of the key parts of the New Testament which utterly undermined slavery in the Christian world. That struck a death blow to the Roman idea of slavery, that one person would be superior over another person and could do with them what they wanted. Now, he's your brother, not your slave, and receive him as a brother. But also, and I want us to see this as well, that Paul even puts himself into the situation. Whatever he's wronged you, whatever he's cost you, I'll pay the price, is what Paul says. I'll pay the price of whatever Onesimus has done. Put it to my account. He says, I'm writing this with my own hand. Pretty much, he's writing a blank check to Philemon. I'll pay for it. But it's more than that, isn't it? It's his reputation. He's vouching for him. He's saying, I've seen the transformation in this brother of yours. And so welcome him in as a brother, just as you would welcome me in. Isn't that amazing? And again, we see here, Paul isn't using his authority. Which brings us into our next point. Persuasiveness. How does Paul show persuasiveness to be those helpers that we want to be in helping other people reconcile? Well, as we just said, he didn't rely on his authority. Even though he had authority, you know, he was an apostle, he was fundamental to the setting up of so many churches in that area and the conversion of so many people that they would have known. He doesn't use that authority, and he makes a point of that in the letter. You know, I could command you, but actually I want to appeal to you through love on this basis. And so he doesn't just lay down the law. He's not interested in authoritarian unity, Paul. He shows his heart for both Onesimus and Philemon in all of this. The warmth of the language that we get in this letter is just tremendous, isn't it? I just want to read a little bit of that to you, because it's a tremendously warm letter. So, for example, in verse 12, we get these words, I'm sending him back to you, sending my very heart. Or when he's writing to Philemon and speaking to Philemon, just get some of these words in verses 4 to 7. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have towards the Lord Jesus and for all of the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. And verse 7, I think, shows the humility of Paul as well. Here's Paul, the great apostle, but he's been blessed by Philemon and his household. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love. My brother, because of the hearts of the saints, have been refreshed through you. See how wonderfully complimentary Paul is towards this brother Philemon, and how he uses powerful persuasion in this case. He's not getting his back up straight away, but he's showing incredibly warm and passionate language towards his brother Philemon and about his brother Onesimus as well. He also shows that he expects a godly response from Philemon. He's not saying, well, I don't think this is going to work, but here we go. But he's fully expectant, because he knows the heart of Philemon. He knows his brother, and he knows he's committed to Jesus Christ. And so he's fully expectant in verse 21, confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. You know, he thinks highly of this man, and that just kind of oozes out of this wonderfully warm letter that he writes. Well, what can we learn about this? Well, tragically, churches are divided. Churches do splinter, they do fall out. And sometimes churches divide over trivial things that should never be really an issue at all. Maybe it's about the way the church is using its money. Maybe it's about decor choices or music tastes or various smaller ministries. And tragically, those things happen. But if we have the same heart here that we're being urged to have by Paul, if we have the same heart towards one another, viewing each other as brothers and sisters in the Lord, not just people that are standing in our way from getting what we want, but a beloved brother whom we care about, that would change everything. If we had the same passion for the unity of the body of believers, which Paul seems to have in helping them to agree with one another, and we helped each other to resolve each other's conflicts and difficulties, willing to get involved at times, yes, then things could be substantially better. Even worse, sometimes people fall out over things which are really important and need to be discussed, things like doctrine and church teaching. But even in this case, pride can have a pernicious impact upon these debates. Sometimes you can even be on the right side of the debate. You can be right about it, but you can be utterly unbiblical and callous in the way that you deal with brothers and sisters. That is, because we're right, we kind of lord it over another person when we're proved right. Oh, I told you so, didn't I? If we went down that route, it would cause these problems. Or we start to despise other people when they've been shown to be wrong on numerous occasions, and so we don't want to listen to them again. Arrogant, closed hearts, unteachable hearts, unreasonable hearts, they can be fatal to church unity. And the tragedy of that as well is that we ourselves can no longer be fed in quite the same way. You know, when we have an arrogant heart, when someone confronts us with something about what we're doing that we shouldn't be doing, or something we said that isn't quite right, what's our first response? All of a sudden, whereas I did this for this reason, or I did that for that reason, we get protective very quickly. Rather than saying, well, I really thank you that you brought that to my attention, I probably need to go away and pray about that and think about that, and can we meet up for a discussion about that? We suddenly become defensive. We perhaps strike back, well, you're telling me not to do that, but what about you? I've seen you do the very same thing. We go on the offensive. That, again, it's because our pride is being touched. Our pride is being offended. Pride by nature is a very competitive thing. C.S. Lewis says this in one of his books, that often proud people will have a lot of problem with other proud people. If you find yourself noticing proud people and being wound up by proud people, may I implore you, brother, sister, look at your own heart. I can see it in my own heart, and it's a real problem. If you haven't got a problem with pride, then I can assure you, you definitely do. Because anyone who thinks they haven't got a problem has probably got a problem that really does need addressing. Because it's pernicious. It's a slippery fish. You think you've got hold of it all of a sudden. Finally, I've resolved the problem of pride, and before you know it, pride is seeping back in because I've conquered my pride. And you think you've done something right. It's the enemy that we always need to be keeping an eye on. It's the one we can never allow to just fester somewhere in the back room of our heart and go unchecked. It will cause all manner of chaos within our own fellowship, brothers and sisters. And if you love this community of God's people, may I urge you, may I plead with you, put to death your pride. Put to death the sin of arrogance within you. And we will have a far more beautiful communion of God's people here within the church. Our final point, we've looked at the example of Euodia and Syntyche. We've looked at Philemon and Onesimus. But our final point is how this interacts with the very gospel at the heart of our faith. There's more than just a good thing we should do is make sure we can reconcile, more than just practical advice. The thing about the Christian faith particularly is that this is wound into the very heart of the gospel, the very heart of the message of Christianity, the very heart of what God has done in our world. You see, division was never supposed to be part of the picture. One very prominent church leader once said that there is such a thing as good disagreement. But actually there isn't. Just as Euodia and Syntyche were, they were told to agree in the Lord, that these divisions were never actually supposed to be part of the picture. We were supposed to have unity in truth. And so where does it come from? Well, it comes from the fall. It comes from where Adam and Eve chose to disobey God. And when they disobeyed God, three fundamental relationships were damaged. The first one was that the relationship between mankind and creation was damaged. And we see that in the pronouncement of the curses that would follow. That the earth would no longer be easy to tend, that it would be fighting against humanity, and humanity would be exploiting the earth. The second one that we have as well is that mankind's relationship with each other would be damaged. And we see that in the pronouncement of the curse between Adam and Eve. That would mean that he would seek to dominate Eve and Eve would seek to usurp him. And so human relationships would thenceforth be full of conflict and self-interest with one another. But thirdly, and most importantly, our relationship with God was severed and damaged permanently at that point. And we see this even in the Tower of Babel, where human beings are able somehow to come together and to have some sort of unity with each other, but set against God. And that's completely the wrong way around, according to the scriptures. It's because first, we must restore our relationship with God. And when our relationship with God is restored, then our relationship with each other can properly be restored. In 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 25, Eli asks this of his sons: if anyone sins against the Lord, who can intercede for him? The idea being that, you know, if human beings fall out, the Lord can intercede between those human beings. But if we've sinned against God, if we've offended God, if we've torn that relationship apart with God, who can intercede between a sinful man like us and God? Every other human being is a sinner in rebellion to God as well. Who can intercede for us? There is no human being on this planet who can do that. And worst of all, the problem that we find there is in our own hearts. Because humankind actually don't want to reconcile with God, and that's the crux of the issue. We don't want to repair that relationship. Like two people who have fallen out years before, it's not like they're both wanting to reconcile. You see, one of them may be still bitter about things, one of them may be still be angry about things, seething in their despising that other person and the things that they've done. And that's how it is with humanity. We want nothing to do with God. We want nothing to do with his rules and his rule in our life. We want to be our own kings. We want to rule our own destiny and say what goes in our own lives. We don't want to follow his loving care for us and his loving instructions for us. We're utterly alienated from him, cut off from him, cut off from the very giver and author and fountain of life. We don't want to seek forgiveness or reconciliation. We don't want to make bridges or anything like that. Even if we could, we don't want to. But what can be done then for our hearts? What can be done for our desperately sick hearts that don't seek after God? Full of sin, unable to repair that relationship. Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, God's own Son. His Son from all eternity steps down into this world. He demonstrates what it is to show true humility as the very Lord of heaven. The one who sat on the throne of heaven for all eternity, enthroned in glory and light and splendor. The one whom the angels sung praises to at the dawn of creation. He steps into this world, is born into the very poverty of a manger, to a peasant girl, in a situation that would have many people raising their eyebrows. And he goes about this world demonstrating incredible humility, healing the sick, teaching people like no one else has ever taught before, performing wondrous miracles and signs, controlling nature, driving out demons. And what do? We brutally mutilate and execute him on a Roman cross. We murder the very author of life. And that really shows what the human heart is like. That shows what your heart is like. Because that very same heart in the Jewish authorities and the Roman authorities, which did that to the very author of life, beats in your chest as well. That very same tendency is in me as well, to hate God and to despise God, so much so that we would get rid of him, when the one who is the very embodiment of goodness and righteousness and justice comes into this world. But in doing so, the wonderful twist is he pays for our rebellion. He pays the penalty for our rejection of God. He pays the penalty for that wrong which severed that relationship in the first place. And he paves the way that we can come back to God. He makes a path open to us, and he sets us upon that path. He forgives us of our sins. He gives us a new heart, one that is no longer inclined to hatred towards God. Instead of a heart of stone, he gives us a heart of flesh that beats after the God who made us. But the wonderful benefit of that is that yes, he restores our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Yes, he brings us back into communion with the one who made us and brings us peace with God. But the outworking of that is what we get in Ephesians chapter 2 and verses 14 to 19, is that our relationships with other people are restored as well. Now, just a bit of a background to Ephesians chapter 2 is that there's a division in humanity that Paul's describing here. That is between the ancient people of God, the Jews, and the Gentiles. And this was an early division in the church as well. You had groups of people falling out with each other as well about how things were to be done. But notice how Paul shows that these two are reconciled. He talks of Jesus Christ in verse 14, "For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in the ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of the two." That no longer should we even consider humanity separated out into Jew and Gentile, because out of those two, he has made one new man, one new people of God, Jew and Gentile, bound together in Christ Jesus, in his body, in the place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And that is the wonderful truth of the gospel, that as we all grow closer to God, just like the sides of a triangle, we will inevitably grow closer to each other. Brothers and sisters, may I say to you, it is impossible to grow in holiness, to grow closer to God, to become more like him, and not grow warmer and more forgiving towards your fellow brothers and sisters. If you think you're growing in holiness, and you're growing more and more angry and bitter and frustrated with your brothers and sisters, then, brothers and sisters, may I implore you to think again what you think holiness is. For when we are filled full of the holiness of God and we're growing closer to God, we will by nature grow closer to one another. We will by nature grow more concerned about the well-being of our brothers and sisters. We will by inevitable nature want to help one another in their walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Holiness isn't about walking around with our nose in the air thinking we're doing better than other people, looking down at them and going, oh no, that's definitely wrong. Jesus did not have time for the scribes and the Pharisees which did that. Instead, he had time for those who were considered sinners, those who were considered outcasts, the tax collectors, that he might bring the good news of the gospel of the kingdom of heaven to them as well, that he might restore them to God, because that was the very beating heart of God himself, so much so that he would send Jesus into the world, that we could dwell in peace, that one day there would be a humanity perfectly bound together, where there will no longer be argument, where there will no longer be division or bitterness or anger, but we will dwell in perfect unity with our Lord Jesus Christ forever. Well, I hope that's an encouragement to you. It's been incredibly convicting to me in the preparation of this, because we notice on a daily basis that we do fall out with one another. My particular hope and prayer is that everyone, without exception, that listens to this would take time to think and pray about their relationships, and particularly think about and pray about people they may need to reach out to, may need to apologize to, may need to help reconcile with one another, and that none of us would go, well, that's interesting for a future time. But actually, every single one of us would think about, no, how can we do this better? Because it applies to all of us, and if we don't think it does, it applies to us then the most. Thank you very much. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you that you don't call us into relationships with one another that are characterized by indifference or distance, but Lord, you draw us into close, intimate relationships with other believers. Lord, that we are to know each other personally, that we are to grow close to each other. And yes, Lord, that means we will grow more aware of their sins. But Lord, that that would give us a greater heart for each other's sanctification, a greater heart for each other's restoration and drawing closer to you. Lord, we pray that you would give us each a heart of humility. Lord, help us to pray and examine our own hearts in light of this truth. Give us perhaps time this evening to do that. Lord, give us time to really think about those that we can improve our relationships with. Lord, allow us to have no refuge or hiding place for pride or arrogance in our lives. And Father God, we pray that by your grace, you would fix our eyes all the more on the Lord Jesus Christ. If there's anyone here this evening that's listening to this, Lord, that has not been reconciled with him first, Lord, we pray that indeed that that relationship would be restored, that person would have peace with you through the blood of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now we're going to sing a wonderful modern hymn, and that is, "There is a hope that burns within my heart."
Thank you.
Now may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may, with one voice, glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen.